Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. The origin story of Jesus starts with the calling of Abraham and the pledge that his offspring would inherit the promised land and become a platform for the future Messiah. The land was theirs as long as they didn't engage in idolatry. However, there was little in the way of holiness, and they were forcibly evicted. The Kabbalistic movement fomented a number of wars to retake the land, conveniently ignoring the fact that Jesus had kicked them out because they were rebelliously pursuing their serpent Messiah. Yet all was not lost. God told Ezekiel there would be a resurrection of the righteous Hebrews during the millennial kingdom, and they would be returned to the promised land. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And we're going to be talking today about the curse continues. So, Jesus in the chapel, would you stand with us right now? We're going to pray. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you and praise you right now for these moments we have here today. I thank you, Father God, that your Holy Spirit is going to be working through me. And most of all, Father God, working in each person. Because if they don't understand the message, then we have been preaching in vain. So I thank you right now for your Holy Spirit working both with me and everyone listening. And this we ask in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen and amen. You may be seated. We're beginning here with our virtual time run. And let me just read to you here from our outline. This is a meeting of the Godhead. After the destruction of Jerusalem, the Godhead paused the virtual time run to discuss what would take place next. The remnant of Jews taken to Babylon would be there for 70 years, which meant that the adults who had left Jerusalem would die before the 70-year period ended. They examined the faithfulness of Ezekiel and how he had been given numerous prophecies against Judah, but also for a number of nations in the region. They reviewed that in time Jesus would be incarnated and start his earthly ministry, but the Son of God would return in the future to reign and establish the 1,000-year millennium kingdom. And for God, this is only 1,000 years is one day. The descendants of the tribes of Israel will play a role at this future time. And it was decided that God would provide Ezekiel with a prophecy about the time just before the great white throne judgment. They knew that no one would understand the prophecy until after the resurrection and ascension of Jesus. Then a final revelation was given to the Apostle John in the future. And then Jesus was commissioned to give the lengthy prophecy to Ezekiel. If you look at the bottom of your outline here, we have a scripture here from 2 Peter 3:8. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is for the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The revelation to the Apostle Peter allows us to convert eternity time into earthly time. We can deduce that God's eternity time by dividing 1,000 years by 24 hours, and thus 1 hour with God, is 41.67 years for man. 1 minute with God is 8 months and 8 days for us. So when God said, just a minute, I'll be with you, it will be 8 months and 8 days later. 1 second with God is 3 days and 22 hours for man. So we have this conversion table that God gave to Peter. So it's going to be a 1,000-year kingdom. In the Old Testament, there was not given too much information on that. And so even when Jesus was here, he didn't speak too much about the 1,000-year kingdom. And it was not until after the book of Revelation that we understood that there's going to be a time of 1,000 years. You got to understand now that a number of pastors and theologians do not believe in a 1,000-year kingdom. They think it is simply not true. It is just an allegory. And they don't believe that the Antichrist is real. They believe that's an allegory. So most of the churches have a destruction when it comes to understanding the end times. But let's get into now a historical background. I want now to share with you what has happened and what will happen. We start in Isaiah chapter 55. So Isaiah, the 55th chapter, and verse number 10 and 11. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven and return not thither, but waters the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that he may seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please. It shall prosper the thing whereto I sent it. You're going to have to make up your mind. Are you going to believe the Bible, or are you going to believe secular people, renegade pastors that are simply saying, well, we don't really know? I have made a decision long time ago that I believe that the Bible, as I have it in King James, is the real Word of God. I believe that if God said it, it's settled, it will not change. So with that understanding, let's look upon the history here now. About 970 years prior to Ezekiel in Babylon, Jesus gave Israel a choice. Number one, they could walk in obedience and receive a blessing. Number two, the other option was being cursed if they turned to idolatry, including was a guarantee that the Israelites would lose the promised land if they embraced idolatry. So let's turn to Deuteronomy chapter 28 and read this to see exactly what did God, or what did Jesus, actually is the one that spoke this, what did Jesus say? So we pick it up in Deuteronomy 28, 1 through 15. It shall come to pass, if you shall hearken, hearken means listen, diligently unto the voice of the Lord your God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command you this day, that the Lord your God will set you on high above all nations of the earth. This was not only a prophecy here to, or a promise to Israel. This also applies to every believer in Christ. The church is included in this. So you and I have an opportunity. We have a choice to be blessed or to be cursed. And by the way, in the Bible, we have 92 curses that Jesus has spoken. 92 curses. And just because you are saved does not mean that the curses go away. You have to apply them. And that's what we do in deliverance. We go through and we break all these curses. Let's continue to verse 2 now. And all these blessings shall come on you, overtake you, if you shall hearken unto the voice of the Lord your God. Blessed shall you be in the city, blessed shall you be in the field, blessed shall be the fruit of your body, and the fruit of your ground, and the fruit of your cattle, the increase of your kind, and the flocks of your sheep. And in the verses coming here, God simply says this: I'm going to bless your home, I'm going to bless your business, I'm going to bless everything you have, I'm going to bless you socks off. And then if you pick it up here in verse number 13, and the Lord shall make you the head, not the tail. You shall be above only, and you shall not be beneath. If that you hearken or listen unto the commandment of the Lord your God, which I command you this day to observe and to do them. You shall not go aside from any of the words I command you this day, to the right hand or to the left, to go after other gods, to serve them. But it shall come to pass, if you will not hearken to the voice of the Lord your God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command you this day, that all these curses shall come upon you and overtake you. I want you to understand this now, because this applies to us as individuals. God is simply saying to Israel, I want to bless you. I want to bless everything you have. I want to give you a good time. I want you to have the best possible life on earth. But then he said, if you're not going to walk with me, if you're not going to obey me, then I will curse you. Let's stop right now. Is God love? Yes. But he's also God of judgment. This means that God's perfect will is to bless us. But if we rebel, he can bless us. And he will curse us, and he will cause us to have all kinds of difficulties. And eventually, he will kill us. This might sound harsh to you, but this is the biblical truth. In the same chapter, now turn with me to verse number 64. This was now a curse against Israel, the 12 tribes of Israel. And the Lord shall scatter you among all people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other, and there you shall serve other gods, which neither you nor your father have known, even wood and stone. And among these nations shall you find no ease, neither shall the sole of your foot have rest. But the Lord shall give you there a trembling heart, failing of eyes, sorrow of mind, and your life shall hang in doubt before you. You shall fear day and night, and shall have none assurance of your life. In the morning you shall say, would God it were even, and at even shall say, would God it were morning. For the fear of your heart, wherewith you shall fear, and for the sight of your eyes, which you shall see. And the Lord shall bring you into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto you, you shall see it no more again. There you shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and women, and no man shall buy you. I want you to understand, this curse was spoken by Jesus about 3,700, 800 years when Moses was alive. So let's say 3,700 years. We have it written there. And I'm going to show you today that because Israel, the 12 tribes, decided not to walk with God, but to walk away from God, that this prophecy has been applied to them, this curse has been applied to them, and that every Jewish person living today, if they are not saved, have the curse over them. There is a specific disease. It's a blood disease that is only found among Jewish people. This is another part of the curse. Let's look at the outline now, page number one. The 10 northern tribes of Israel were ejected from the land in 727 BC when the Assyrians conquered them. The remnant that survived were forcefully marched to Assyria and resettled in different places. They never returned as a group. Now think about this now. God's beloved people, the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the 10 northern tribes. And in 727, we know that historical facts we have not only from the Bible, but we have historical facts that this took place. 10 of the tribes were taken to Assyria, settled in many different places, assimilated, and they never came back. And they never came back. There was a remnant called Samaritans that somehow filtered back into Palestine or to the land of Israel. And you remember reading in the Bible then when Jesus was here, that Jesus traveled from Galilee to Jerusalem and he had to go through Samaria. And the Jews hated the Samaritans because they had married into Gentiles. They were mixed. And yet Jesus went into Samaria, spoke to the woman at the well, and she was saved. She went back to her town, brought people out, and Jesus stayed there for several days preaching the gospel to the Samaritans. Page 2 on the outline. Jerusalem was taken by the Babylonians in 597 BC. And a large portion of the population of Judah was carried away to Babylon. I've been preaching on this the last few Sundays, and there was a grace period of 10 years. Think about this now. I really want you to think today and understand with the Holy Spirit. The Babylonians came to Jerusalem. 597 BC, took the city, took a whole bunch of people out, and took them over to Babylon. And you would think that the remaining Jews would simply say, wow, let's go back to Deuteronomy 28. Let's start to serve God. For 10 years, the prophet Ezekiel thundered against sin in Jerusalem and Judah. And what did people do? They sinned more than before. And finally, In 587, grace period was up. Babylonians came back. The blood was flowing in the street in Jerusalem. The temple was destroyed. Every house was set on fire. And a large group was simply gathered up and taken to Babylon. And Jeremiah had prophesied they're going to be there for 70 years. Ask yourself this. The people that came to Babylon, do you think that they said, wow, we need to come back to God? But the story is this, and this is a sad story. The 10 tribes were gone. We have Judah and Benjamin back. They called Judah and Benjamin for Jews. And the Jews simply continued in their sin with the Kabbalah and with other idolatry. On the outline of page 2, we read this. The 12 tribes of Israel openly scoffed at the warning from God that shows debauchery and depravity instead of holiness. And this is why they lost the promised land. You and I are under the judgment right now. When President Trump was in office, the first 3 years were great. The economy boomed. He opened up for oil production. Gasoline was cheap. We had so much oil in this country, we were exporting it. We had plenty, 3 years of good things. Ask yourself this. Did we, as a nation, take advantage of those 3 good years and say, God, we bless you. I want to go to church. I want to get closer to you. The answer is no. Those 3 years, people bought homes, boats, cars, RVs, traveled. Instead of turning to God, we simply turned to materialism. And I believe the Chinese virus came from China, but I believe that was God's judgment, not upon only the United States, but the entire world, including China, suffered from it. Did we, as a Christian churches, did we really repent during the time of the virus from China? And the answer is no. We closed our churches. We simply had virtual worship. And so God simply, this is what the Holy Spirit is showing to me. God said, okay, so the virus was not enough to make you repent. I'm going to hit you now where it really hurts, in the pocketbook. And we got this yo-yo to President Biden that really doesn't know what he's doing, but God is using him to bring out judgment. And now suddenly, gasoline prices very high, housing market falling apart, people can't afford to raise the interest rates. And now, we are screaming and saying we're just waiting for the elections so that we can get rid of the Democrats. The Democrats is not the problem. The problem is sin in America. With the abortions, homosexuality, transgenderism, men turning into women, women into men. So we got to recognize there's a judgment going here. Let's get back to the outline now. Like, as we look upon what God did to Israel, understand what God is doing to us. By the way, in Europe, right now, in Germany, now President Trump warned Germany, don't rely on Russian natural gas. They said it's cheap. The Russians now cut it off. Many cities in Germany today have no hot water. They turned off a lot of outside lights. And they are telling people in Germany that this winter is going to be tough. There's going to be electric outages. They're getting slammed over there. Just about every country in Europe. Let's go back here now. The Jews from Babylon were allowed to return home in 517 BC to rebuild Jerusalem and the temple, but they will never become an independent nation again. I want you to understand this. The Jews have returned. It was about 40,000. I don't have the numbers in my head right now. But about 40,000 Jews returned to Jerusalem to rebuild it. The majority of the Jewish population in Babylon stayed in Babylon. They had become prosperous. They had businesses. And by the time of Jesus, the Babylonian population, the Jewish population in Babylon was 1 million. And that's why the Apostle Peter eventually went to Babylon and preached and simply established a Christian church among the Jews in Babylon. These things you don't hear in regular churches. They don't talk about this because they don't want you to see the real picture. So here again, the Jews in Babylon, but they were told, you can go home now. They said, 40,000 or so said, we will. Most of them said, why should we go back to that Palestine, to Israel? It's ruined. We don't want to start over again. We already got a good life here. The same holds true for Jewish people in America today. When Israel, they founded Israel in 1947, you didn't find a lot of American Jews going over there, neither British Jews, because they simply said, you know, why should we go to that God-forsaken land and start from scratch? We have a good time here. The remnant that came home slowly built up the population. And then we had between 200 and 150, we had the Maccabean revolts. Maccabean was a family and they revolted. Now, what did they try to do? And I don't have time to really detail that here today. They wanted to kick out the Romans. They wanted to establish Israel again. They wanted to establish their nation. And it was a bloody fight, and they lost it. The insurrection was crushed by the Romans. And tens of thousands of Jewish men were killed during this time period. The prophecy in Deuteronomy 28 now was, you lost the land. Don't try to take it back. But they did. From 104 to 76 BC, there was a civil war between different Jewish factions. We had the Sadducees and the Pharisees were fighting over what? Trying to reestablish Israel. The Jewish leadership in Palestine successfully revolted against Rome in 66 AD. This is after Jesus now. And was able to drive out the hated occupiers from Jerusalem and Judea. The Romans returned 4 years later to conquer Jerusalem and destroy the temple. The destruction was so great that not one stone was left upon another excepting for what is today called a Wailing Wall. According to the historian Josephus, 1.1 million civilians died in Jerusalem, 100,000 in Galilee, and 97,000 young men and women were taken to Egypt and sold into slavery. And some 50,000 soldiers were killed. That was a bloodbath. Now remember here, what we had here in Deuteronomy 28, the last verse. And the Lord shall bring you into Egypt again with ships. By the way whereof I spake unto you, you shall see it no more again, and there you shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you. The Jewish population in Cyprus and Cyrene, which is a province in Egypt, revolted in 115 AD, while a Roman army was waging war against the Persians in the eastern part of the empire. Christianity had grown mightily in Cyprus and Egypt, and the Jewish hatred for Jesus and the followers saw some 460,000 Gentiles slaughtered by the Jewish armed forces. The Roman army returned to Cyprus and Egypt 2 years later, and they squashed it, and 200,000 Jewish people were killed, and again, thousands sold on the Roman slave market. At this time, don't you think that the rabbi should have simply got a light bulb, saying, you know, we got the Maccabeans, we got the Civil War, we got this war in 66 AD, maybe we should read the Old Testament. Maybe we should go back and see what has God spoken. Why do we have these disasters? But you know what? The rabbis never lifted a finger. The slaughter continued. A Jewish political leader named Simon Bar Kokhba, and Bar means son, he was a son of Kokhba, led a strong revolt against Rome in 132 AD. Now he was successful. He recruited a large army, and he held the Romans at bay for the next 4 years. Matter of fact, they destroyed the whole legion, the Roman legion was wiped out, and he declared Judah and Galilee as a Jewish state. And for about 3 or 4 years, he was very successful. And they thought, finally, we have established Israel again as a nation. We're going to bring the Messiah here, the serpent. These were Kabbalistic movements. The Romans massed legions, and the Jews were defeated again in 136 AD. The losses were staggering. 400,000 Jewish soldiers and militia were killed. It is estimated a total of 580,000 Jews were executed. 50 fortified towns were destroyed, and 985 villages was razed. It was brutal. The Roman government at this time now was furious. They simply said, we got to deal with the Jews. They have given us grief for about 200 years. And the only way to deal with them is clean them out. They simply sent in Roman soldiers, detachments, and every Jew was either killed, sold on a slave market, or simply transferred to another country. Palestine, after 136, was free of Jews. None left. Does that sound familiar when Hitler talked about Judenrein getting rid of all the Jews? This was an ethnic cleansing that the world had never seen before. Time now goes. Let me take you up to 1935 to 1945. Jewish people were persecuted in Europe from 1935 to 1945 by Adolf Hitler's soldiers. The official death toll was estimated at 6 million men and women and children. And to date, this has been the most systematic persecution and killing of Jews since the Roman ethnic cleansing in 136 AD. Now, what I'm telling you is simply this. No pastor in America or in Europe would, there are a few, would dare to say that the reason for the Holocaust was the curse that Jesus spoke against the Jewish people, against the people of Israel, the 12 tribes, at the time of Moses. On page number 3, I already read this scripture to you from Deuteronomy 28, 64, 68. And it was not until around 1400 A.D., that small numbers of Jews filtered back and resettled in Jerusalem. Now your question is, what about the state of Israel today? Is that of God? The answer is no. It's the same story as the revolts the Jews have done over the years. It's a Kabbalistic movement where they simply decided back in the 1800s, to re-establish Israel and to set it up as a nation again. God was not in it. Lucifer was in it because they are setting things up for the time of the Antichrist. That does not mean that I hate Jews, that I don't like them. I feel sorry for them. I feel sorry for the people. They are misled by the rabbis. Just like we have Christians today in America and in Western Europe. And we got bad pastors. And we got bastard Bibles. I feel sorry for the Christians that are living an inferior life. Many are not even born again. So, what I want to share with you here is simply this. The Word of God will never change. That's why there's no peace in the Middle East. There will be no peace until Jesus comes back. The Jews are going to have a problem. They have a problem with Iran right now. They're going to continue their problems because they are illegally in the land. Let me repeat that. They are illegally in the land. They have violated God's word and said, we're going to take the land back. And God said, I kicked you out. No, we're going to take it back. The curse is there. Let's talk about a thousand-year kingdom now. So turn with me to Revelation Chapter 1. And this is an amazing revelation that we have here that probably most people really don't appreciate. So Revelation Chapter 1. And let me get to it here. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servant things which must shortly come to pass, and he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bare record of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ, and all the things that he saw. Blessed he that reads and that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you, and peace from him which is, and which was, and which is to come, and for the seven spirits which are before the throne. And then we read this in verse number 10. I was in the spirit of the Lord's day, heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and what you see write in a book, send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, unto Laodicea. He was now in heaven. He had a revelation. And that revelation was beyond what God had revealed before. In Revelation chapter 20, we are not told about the thousand-year kingdom. And it's very just a few verses. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having a key of the bottomless pit, and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil, and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into a bottomless pit, shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nation no more till 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that he must be loosed a little season. And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. I saw the souls that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus, and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither have received his mark upon their foreheads, or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. This is a chapter, it's very skimpy. So we're going to have 1,000 years. There's going to be a number of things happening there. Let me take you now to the outline here. And we're going to come back to Revelation to keep your finger there, but turn to Isaiah chapter 11. That's the book of Isaiah chapter 11. Now, Isaiah received a prophecy here about the thousand-year kingdom. He didn't know it was a thousand-year kingdom. He just received a prophecy. So let me say this to you. God has, for the time of Adam and Eve, given prophetic words. It's like a puzzle. Different centuries, different millenniums. You get a glimpse here, a glimpse there. And then it was not be able to understood. We got the book of Revelation. And with the book of Revelation now, suddenly the pictures of the different prophecies, we take them out like a puzzle, put them on the table, and now there's a picture. In Isaiah chapter 11, and I want to just pick it up here from verse number 4. And this is, let me go to number 1. And there shall go forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. That's Jesus. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge, and of the fear of the Lord. And shall make him a quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. The wolf also shall dwell with a lamb, the leopard shall lie down with a kid, the calf and a young lion and the fatling together, and the little child shall lead them. And the cow and a bear shall feed, their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. And the sucking child shall play on the hole of an asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the cockatrice den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. And in the day shall be the root of Jesse, that's Jesus, which shall stand for an ensign of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and its rest shall be glorious. Now, I see I received that when he lived about 600 years before Christ. Did he understand that? No, he did not. Back to the outline on page 3 now. In Revelation, Jesus told John a strange thing. After the 1,000 years are expired, Lucifer will be loosed from the bottomless pit to entice those who were born during the millennium to rebel against God. The devil will teach people to make weapons, raise an army, and take the fight to Israel and Jerusalem. The war will culminate when Jesus throws Lucifer into the lake of fire and kills the insurgents. Let's turn to Revelation 20 now. If you pick it up here in verse number 7. And when 1,000 years are expired, by the way, what I see as so was, animal kingdom will be changed. No more killing. All animals will eat plants. They'll be vegetarians. We can simply pick up snakes. They don't have any poison left. It's going to be a fantastic 1,000 years when you can walk around. No mosquitoes will bite you. No ants will bite you. It's going to be a perfect paradise for 1,000 years. And then Jesus said this, verse 7, Revelation 20. And when 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison, and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about and the beloved city, and fire came down from God of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast in the lake of fire and brimstone with the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. That's a description of a war. Now, God simply told, or Jesus told, Ezekiel how the war is going to go. So we have a description given to Ezekiel 2,580 years ago. He did not know that he was describing a future war. So let's turn to Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel chapter 37. And this is called the Valley of Dry Bones. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley which was full of bones. And he caused me to pass by them round about, and behold, they were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. This is referring to the resurrection of the 12 tribes of Israel. There were people among the 12 tribes that really believed in the future Messiah, that had repented of their sins, and they were seeking the Lord. They were born by looking forward to the cross or the future Messiah as we are looking back. Again, he said unto me, and I'm now in Ezekiel chapter 37, verse 4. Again, it said to me, prophesy upon these bones and say to them, O you dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus is the Lord God unto these bones. Behold, I will cause breath to enter into you. You shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you and will bring up flesh upon you and cover you with skin, put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall be known that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as was commanded. As I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to bone. And when I beheld, sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. Then said unto me, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus says the Lord God, come forth from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they might live. So I prophesied and commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood upon their feet, an exceeding great army. This is the resurrection that will take place of the 12 tribes of Israel. They have come out of the graves, and just like we are in heaven, believers in Christ, our soul and spirit are in heaven, our bodies are laying on earth someplace, decayed. God is going to resurrect our bodies. He's going to take our spirit and soul and put them together, and that's exactly the description here of the people here from Israel. So, verse number 11. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel, 12 tribes. Behold, I say, our bones are dried and our hope is lost. We are cut off for our parts. Therefore, prophesy and say unto them, thus is the Lord God. Behold, O my people, I will open your graves. He's talking about those who are dead. And cause you to come up of your graves. And bring you into the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord. When I opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up out of your graves. And I shall put my spirit in you. And you shall live, and I shall place you in your own land. Then shall you know that I, Lord, have spoken it, and performed it, says the Lord. So here's a prophecy now that the Jewish rabbis and the Kabbalistic leaders have missed. In the Kabbalah, they simply say this: we have to establish a land. We have to do this. We have to bring the Messiah up. And God said, I am going to bring them up out of the graves. God said, I will put my breath into them. I will sanctify them. I will have my spirit upon them. There are two different events. You have God's event, which is supernaturally. You have the Jewish way, which in the flesh, using weapons that they have. They had it in swords in the old days. Now they got airplanes, guns, bombs, lasers, whatever they have, drones. But they are using weapons. And I want you to see the difference now. God said, I will raise them up. I will do it. The Jewish leadership said, no, we're going to do it ourselves. We are going to establish the nation again. And they are in direct conflict with God. And there's a time where the Bible describes, I don't have time to get into today, called Jacob's trouble. It's going to be hell. It's going to break loose in Israel. And the Jews that are living there are going to flee for their lives during the time of the Antichrist. So let me do a sum over here now to summarize this. And I can see here that I got more scriptures and more stuff here than I have time for today. Let me just hit some of the points here. This prophecy will be fulfilled after the second return of Jesus and the beginning of the millennium kingdom. The political state of Israel that exists today is no different than all the previous attempts to reestablish Israel as a nation, from the Maccabeans to Kochba and all the others. Enoch lived prior to Noah's flood. He was taken to heaven and given wonderful revelation about the coming Redeemer that will come to the earth in the future to judge the ungodly. He recorded his experiences, but for some reason his writing never made it into the Old Testament. Enoch is mentioned twice in the Bible, each time in glowing terms. And you find it in Genesis 5, 18 through 24, and Hebrews 11, 5. We can conclude that Noah possessed the recorded history that dated back to Adam and Eve, along with the books of Enoch, and used information therein to establish the genealogy from Adam to himself. And you find it in Genesis 5, 1 through 32. Job was a man of righteousness. He was severely attacked by Lucifer. He made a statement during his suffering showing that he knew his Redeemer was alive and one day he would be resurrected. Job was a contemporary of Abraham, but he lived in what today is Yemen. Thus, Job's knowledge of the Redeemer must have come for the books of Enoch. Let's just flip here quickly to Job chapter 19. That's Job chapter 19. And let me find it myself. Chapter 19. That's Job 19. And we begin it in verse number 23. He said, all of my words were now written, or they were printed in the book, that they were graven with an iron pen and lead in a rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives. He shall stand at the latter day upon the earth, and though after my skin worm destroyed his body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another, through my reins be consumed within me. This profession of faith was a knowledge out of Redeemer to come. And this is exactly what the people in Israel had too, those that accepted the Redeemer and believed in that. And they are going to be in the thousand-year kingdom and then in heaven. So let me give to the summary here. So what I just did was an introduction to Ezekiel's prophecies about the end times. It is a sad story of stiff-necked people, who were selected by God to be custodians of the Word of God and the home for the future Messiah. They were given a strong initial warning that the promised land was only theirs if they walked with the Lord and did not serve demon gods. So today, Jews are back in Israel. Christian Zionists are simply gloating over and saying, you know, the word of God has come through. No, it was not prophesied that the Jews would take the land back by power, by military might. It was just another attempt that they did. So what's the story now? The story is simple this. We are coming into a very heavy confrontation. The Antichrist is going to be Jewish. The entire system of the Antichrist is going to be a Kabbalistic system. We're going to have the Antichrist in Jerusalem. We're going to have, in the beginning, the Christians would simply say, we got a prophecy, it's here, the whole world. They are not going to understand that the Antichrist is not Jesus. It's going to be a disaster. We have the information from the Bible, what is true. The message I preach today, in the future, even now, if this message was publicized so that it became publicly known in the United States, there would be an uproar. I would be called an anti-Semite. I would be told that we need to close this church down. This message cannot be spoken. We have come to the time now that truth is a lie and lie is a truth. In order for you to really understand this, I just gave you a lecture here today. You need to take the message, sit down this afternoon or this week, look up the scriptures, read it in the Bible, ask God to give you revelation and understanding so that you will know what has happened, what will happen, and the curse will continue on the Jewish people. There are some of you that have been listening to me today that are not saved. And you're simply saying this, well, I don't want to be part of the Antichrist. I want to be a Christian. I want to know Jesus. How do I get in? Well, you have, it's very simple. Confess that you're a sinner. Confess that you believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Confess that you believe that Jesus died on the cross, rose from the dead. He paid for your sins on the cross. And then simply say, God, forgive me. Jesus, come into my life and save me. And he will. The good news is that when we finish here, there are three crosses coming up on your screen. And you're going to hear the voice of Pastor Charles saying this, my friend, he's going to take 10 minutes and go through with you step by step how to be saved, have a little prayer with you, and you can know today that you have been saved. If you do that, would you contact us? We would like to encourage you to pray with you and just rejoice with you. And to those of you that are Christians, think deeply and simply say, I need to study this message, not one time, not twice, but several times. Understand that when God is cursing, there will be bad things happening. Bad things happen to the Jews. There are 92 curses in the Old Testament that apply to all Christians as well as the Jews. And when you break one of those, there will be a judgment and there will be a negative response. So maybe we should simply come to the conclusion, if God said it, I believe it, that settles it, I need to line up with God. And I pray that you today will line up with God, seek your heart, search your heart, and then say, God, if there's any wickedness in me, take it out. I don't want to be cursed. God bless you. Here's Pastor Charles.
Father God, the message today was pretty clear. As we read the Bible, we simply have a choice to accept it or reject it. If we're going to say that we're Christians and that we believe that the Bible is the Word of God, we cannot be selective in our application of it. We simply have to look at it and say, if God said it, that simply settles it. Father God, help us to, when it comes to things related to Israel and the political state of Israel and the line of thought that's being perpetrated by Christian Zionists in our country, this message today was not politically correct. It was biblically correct, but it's not politically correct. And it's certainly not going to be popular in Christian Zionist churches. But Father God, we ask that your Holy Spirit will just go out and touch people and convict them and show them the truth. Just like you got a hold of people in the past, that your Holy Spirit just comes out. And we don't have to be your Holy Spirit. You can be your own Holy Spirit. Help us, God, to simply be witnesses, to present truth. And then, Father God, we can simply rely upon the fact that your Holy Spirit will be there to back us up as we present biblical truth. Even if it's not popular, even if it's not convenient, truth is truth. And we thank you for this now. In Jesus' name, amen. Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 76th part in the series, The Origin Story of Jesus, and was entitled, The Curse Continues. The origin story of Jesus starts with the calling of Abraham and the pledge that his offspring would inherit the promised land and become a platform for the future Messiah. The land was theirs as long as they didn't engage in idolatry. However, there was little in the way of holiness, and they were forcibly evicted. The renegade Kabbalistic movement fomented a number of wars to retake the land that God had promised them, conveniently ignoring the fact that Jesus had kicked them out because they were rebelliously pursuing their serpent Messiah. Even in the present day, not much has changed. Yet God told Ezekiel that all was not lost. Someday in the future, there would be a resurrection of Hebrews who had walked with God and exercised faith in the coming Messiah. The Jews alive at the time of the prophecy would not see it fulfilled, but they were given a hope of a future resurrection and a return to the promised land. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1871. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.